Pastor Dwayne Madden has a certificate from the University of the West Indies in Principles and Techniques in Counseling. The Lord called him to Bible College, where he enrolled at Fairview Baptist Bible College in 1998, and in 2001 graduated with a diploma in pastoral studies. In 2002, an opportunity was presented for him to become the administrator of Fairview Baptist Bible College, where he served in that capacity until April 2008. In January 2008, he answered the call to ministry and was appointed the pastor of Hillview Baptist Church, which is his current position. At Hillview Baptist Church, Pastor Madden engages in various ministries, including preaching, teaching, discipling, evangelism, outreach ministry, and men's ministry, among other ministries. Pastor Madden also currently teaches at the Fairview Bible College. He has done further studies with Cedarville University in the United States from 2004 to 2008. In 2018, Pastor Dwayne Madden acquired his Bachelor of Arts degree in ministry at Piedmont International University online. Be blessed as Pastor Madden now will bring to us the Word of God.
Greetings, 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 Good News Baptist Church in St. Martin. It is good to actually use this opportunity virtually. I am Pastor Dwayne Madden, all the way from Hillview Baptist Church in Montego Bay, Jamaica. I want to first of all wish all the mothers Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day. This should be aired on Mother's Day, so Happy Mother's Day to all of you. I also want to wish the Good News Baptist Church in St. Martin, I want to wish you all happy anniversary. You're celebrating another milestone. Anniversaries are good, and that is something that we all must make sure that we mark as milestones. So I want to wish you happy anniversary, Good News Baptist Church, and to Pastor Webster and Pastor White, thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak. Now, everyone knows what's going on in these times. It's all over the news and it's all over the world. It's the coronavirus, the COVID-19 pandemic. And it is causing the world to pay attention. Different parts of the world are paying attention to different things. But it should cause us as Christians, all of us as believers, to pay attention to our God and His Word. And so in these times, I know you are trying to figure out what's going to happen next. What should you do? And so I'm aware that you are looking at this theme for today about going forward after COVID, going forward after COVID. And so I want to talk to you about this idea that you're going to need faith to go forward. F-A-I-T-H, faith to go forward, because it is indeed trying times. Who would have told us that the entire world would have just stopped in its tracks to actually go at a standstill or come to a standstill? These are indeed the signs of the times. These are indeed the times when we should be looking up. But we're still living. We're still going on. So how do we get along? How do we get forward? How do we go along our journey? We don't even know how long this is going to take. Some of us actually thought that we would have been over by now, true? Some of us thought that we would have been back to normal, but it seems like it's getting worse. And I want to encourage you, Good News Baptist Church, from these words, faith that endures and overcomes. I want to talk to you on this topic, faith that endures and overcomes. You know why? In these times, you are going to need faith. You are going to need faith. This is the kind of faith that has to be strong and has to be stable. You're going to need the faith that will, you have to dig deep. You have to dig deep, and you're going to need the faith that will give you endurance and the faith that will remind you that you overcome. So I want to talk to you on that. And so I want to remind you and encourage you on this first point, that you have to endure to the end. We're going through difficult times. No doubt some of you have lost your jobs. No doubt some of you are struggling to make ends meet. No doubt some of you are wondering, how long will this be? In fact, all of us are. Some of us are going through difficult economic times. It's like a week by week, month by month, even day by day situation. And you might be wondering, how are we going to cope with all of this? How are we going to cope with COVID? So here's the thing. You need to endure to the end. It's about endurance, because it's here. The COVID-19 is here, and we're going through it. And so you're going to need that faith to endure to the end. And there are some passages that remind us how to endure and remind us that we should endure to the end. I want to start with 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 1. Paul wrote this, and he was addressing Timothy, a young pastor in training. And he said, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus." Notice what he says to him at the, on the get-go, you know. He says, "My son, I want you to be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus." That's what we need to do. We need to be strong. If we're going to endure, we're going to have to be strong. My friends, you can't get weary. You can't faint in these times. We will all agree that it's difficult. The times are difficult and the times are hard. But you have to stay strong. In order for you to endure, you have to be strong. And you have to stay strong. And verse 2 says, "And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also." Verse 3 is where I want to make my major point here of enduring. Verse 3 says, "Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ." Thou therefore endure hardness as a soldier of Jesus Christ. Paul is telling Timothy to endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. And by extension, he's talking to every Christian. He's saying we have to endure hardness. Hardness means afflictions. Hardness means hardships. Hardness means tough times. We are going to have to endure hardness, and we are going through a tough time in our world right now. You are going through a tough time in your island of St. Martin right now, but you must endure. This is, can I put it this way? For me, it is not an option. It's mandatory. You must endure hardness. It is not like you have a choice. Yes, you might say, but Pastor Madden, I do have a choice. No, what he wants you to do is that this is a must. If you don't, you are going to let the situation break you in two. And this is not an option for us. If you're a soldier of Jesus Christ, and remember what a soldier is. A soldier is somebody who is dedicated. A soldier is somebody who is disciplined. And a soldier who is somebody who does not give up. But it says here, as a good soldier in Jesus Christ. My friends, endure hardness as a good soldier. I know that we're human beings. But I often put it this way. We are human beings. But if you're a believer, you're a human Christian being. And we live by different principles. We live by different standards. And as soldiers of the cross, we are actually motivated, encouraged, told, and mandated to be good soldiers. So if you're crumbling under the pressure, my friends, might I say it in a loving way, you're not being a good soldier. A good soldier will go through heartache and pain and hardship. A good soldier will go through all kinds of things, but still stands strong, still endures. Being a soldier does not mean that you're exempt from war. Being a soldier does not mean that you're exempt from difficulties. Being a soldier means that you endure through difficulties. Being a soldier means that you are to be prepared to face a war. And boy, are we going through warlike times. So he says, endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. In order to be a good soldier of Jesus Christ, you have to endure hardships. Verse 4 of 2 Timothy chapter 2 says, "No man that warreth," I told you that we're a soldier means that we're going to have to go through all kinds of warfare. "No man," let me put it this way, "no soldier that warreth, entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. If we are in a war, no matter what you do, you can't get out. You never chose this battle. The battle is here. COVID-19 is here. So you have to make sure that you fight the good fight. It doesn't make any sense you say to yourself, boy, I'm just going to give up. That means you would have not proven yourself to be a good soldier. You must endure like a good soldier of Jesus Christ. He says, don't allow the things of life, the affairs of this life, to entangle you. Now, here are some things that you might be thinking about that may be entangling you right now. Where am I going to get the next dollar from? I've lost my job because of COVID-19. I am temporarily laid off. Some people might be temporarily laid off and waiting to resume a job that they don't know when this period will be over. Some of you are actually struggling to find food. Some of you are actually in relationships and family where all of you are in lockdown right now and you're not getting along. All of these things are affairs of life. It says if you're a soldier, you're not going to let the affairs of life wrap you up, entangle you to the point where you begin to worry too much, you get depressed. And I know that some of you are depressed and stressed, but a good soldier fights to the end. A good soldier endures to the end. And he says, do not allow the affairs of life to entangle you, that you may please who? You may please the person who has chosen you to be a soldier. That person is Jesus Christ. You are a soldier. Do not retreat. You're a soldier. Endure this hardship. And please note that the last phrase says, him who has chosen you. You are chosen to be a soldier. Whether you like it or not, you are a soldier, so be a good one. It is best to be a good one than a bad one, because you already have been endowed with the title by Jesus Christ, the chief, the commander. He has said to you, if you're a Christian, you have enrolled in his army and you are a soldier. Soldier, no retreat, no surrender. Endure hardness. Keep going. Do not stop. Man, woman, boy, girl, whoever you are, let's endure this. We can get through this. So I encourage you to endure to the end. Another passage is found in the said 2 Timothy. But 2 Timothy chapter 4, as we continue to look at this idea of enduring to the end. Remember, we're saying you're going to need faith to endure and to overcome. But we're looking at the endurance side of things first. In order to endure, 2 Timothy 4 verse 1 gives us some charges, gives us some activities, gives us some procedures, the way we should carry out ourselves in these times. And so 2 Timothy chapter 4, starting at verse 1, it says, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Let's back up a bit before we go any further. Paul again charging Timothy, and by extension every believer. He says, I charge you before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who is going to judge everyone at his appearing. One day Jesus Christ is going to return. He's going to return for his people. But then you must remember that if you're his people, remember that he's going to also judge us one day. There's a judgment seat of Jesus Christ. And for those of you who are not saved, there's another judgment called the Great White Throne Judgment. But notice what it says. We will all be judged. He will judge the quick and the dead. The quick represents those who are born again. The quick represents those who are saved. The quick represents those who are believers, those who are Christians. And the dead, as the word suggests, represents those who are spiritually dead. The dead represents those who are lost. The dead represents those who are not saved. And notice what he says. Jesus is going to judge the saved and the unsaved. Jesus is going to judge the believer and the unbeliever. No one will escape. And so he says, since you are going to be judged, and one day Jesus is going to return, he says, you must do some things. So let me speak to those of you who are Christians first. You must preach the word. continue to preach the word. These are the times we need to keep in the word. And when people are bringing out all kinds of conspiracy theories and trying to figure out things and to say, this is what is happening, and some of them are going to be false and foolish. It says, preach the word. This is not the time to be telling stories. This is the time to be telling the word, preaching the word, giving out the gospel. No more than ever, people need to hear about Jesus Christ. No more than ever, people need to know that Jesus saves. So preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. Be instant in lockdown and when you get out. Be instant when you are under restrictions, when you are free. In season, out of season, we need to be preaching the word. Find various creative ways, my brothers and sisters, to get the word out in these times. And it says, reprove. Tell a person a fault. Rebuke them. Tell them when they have gone wrong. And then exhort and encourage with all long-suffering and doctrine. Teach the doctrine. And do so with patience and long-suffering. Do not give up. Endure. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. There are some people who don't want to hear any of this right now. There have always been some persons. The time is already now, by the way, that some people will not want to hear a word you have to say. That is why it says you must be consistent in preaching it. Whether they want to hear or forbear, whether they want to hear or not, still preach the word. You don't give up. You let their blood be on their shoulders and not yours. And so it says, but after their own loss shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. That phrase, having itching ears, speaks of people who, it's almost like tickling their ears. They want you to preach something nice and easy. They want you to preach things that they want to hear, things that make them feel good. There are some people like that right now. They don't even want you to talk about sin. It says this is the time that you need to preach about sin, but you also need to preach about salvation and deliverance from sin. So keep the balance. Give the whole gospel. Let them know that they are sinners. Yes, people need to come to that realization, but then you need to let them know that there's a Savior. So let us be diligent in doing that. And it says, and they shall turn away. This is verse 4 of 2 Timothy chapter 4. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. Some people will not want to hear the truth. They will actually follow more of the fake news. They'll follow more of the conspiracy theories. There are some people who will readily believe the fables, the fake stories, the untruth. But then you keep preaching the truth. Verse 5 is where I want to just make that emphasis. Having said all of that, verse 5 says, but watch thou in all things. Endure afflictions. Do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of thy ministry. Look at all the things he was telling us to do. All the things he was telling us to do is ministry, you know. Keep doing your ministry. But tucked away in that is this phrase, endure afflictions. We're still going to have to endure hardships. And by the way, you see that phrase, endure afflictions? It's the same Greek phrase that is used in 2 Timothy chapter 2. When Paul said to Timothy, endure hardness, same Greek word. Endure hardness and endure affliction is the same Greek word. Meaning, it's trying to tell us the same thing. That we are going to have to learn to endure hardships. We are going to have to learn to endure difficulties. We are going to have to learn to endure trials and tribulations. This is not an easy road, but we must keep on traversing it. Do not give up, my friends. No matter how emotionally depressed you feel. Can I just pause to say this? The world over, I know, in different islands and different countries, the world over, there are people right now who are getting depressed. More and more people are getting depressed because of the lockdown that their country might be in. They're getting depressed because they're not as productive and active as they would want to be. There are some people who just don't do well by themselves. There are some people who just don't do well with inactivity. And some persons are just on shutdown. And so before you know it, they become depressed. And it could be possible, Good News Baptist Church, it could be possible that there's somebody right now listening to this, that you're on the edge, the verge of depression. Even more so, you could already be depressed. You're saying, Pastor Madden, I'm already there. Tell me something. Well, I'm telling you to endure it. I'm encouraging you to not give up, because this is what is happening. Some people feel depressed. The next step for some people is going to be suicide. And we don't want that on any of you. We don't want any of you to fall prey to the suicidal thoughts and then the suicidal actions. Do not give up. Yes, the times are hard, but endure to the end. He's telling us the same things. Endure hardships. Do not give up, my friends. And you must make full proof of your ministry. Make use of every opportunity you got. Do what you can before it is too late. The final passage under this idea of enduring to the end is found in James chapter 5. James chapter 5. As we endure, you're going to need faith. You're going to have to dig deep to endure these afflictions. James chapter 5 says, be patient. Verse 7. Be patient, therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman, the farmer, waited for the precious fruit of the earth and hath long patience for it until he received the early and latter rain. He says, be patient. The coming of the Lord is near. So keep waiting, anticipating. Don't give up. He's still coming. But he says, take an example from the farmer who has to wait on the rain in order for his crops to grow. And it mentions he has to wait for the early rain and then the latter rain. The early rain normally comes anywhere between October and November. That is the early rain that he would wait on when he, that is when they are planting their seedlings. And so when they plant the seedlings, they need rain and watering. And so he said the farmer has to wait on that. By the way, God promised them that if they plant, they must also look for these rains. And he says, God said to them in Deuteronomy that I'm going to send you the early rain and the latter rain. But he also said to them in another passage in Deuteronomy, ask for it as well. You have to depend on God, he says. He says, depend on me for that latter rain, which normally comes the next year around March or so or April. And then when they have planted and the early rain comes, and then when it's soon time for harvest, the crops are growing, they're sprouting out nicely, they need the latter rain for them to be ripened and harvested. But they have to depend on God. The farmer has to depend on God for that. Maybe that's where you need to be. Depending on God for daily provisions. Some of you don't know where your food is coming from. You have no paycheck anymore. You're going to have to learn to depend on God. You're going to have to learn to hold on. You're going to have to learn to put your faith and trust. Get deeper in trusting God. Deeper in your faith. Maybe some of you really were not as strong in your faith as you thought you were. No, it's a test of your faith. And so he goes on to say, verse 8, be also patient, establish your hearts, strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draws near. Grudge not one against another, brethren, lest ye be condemned. Behold, the judge standeth before the door. I find it interesting that he puts that verse there. He's telling us to be patient and wait on God. And he says, while you're being patient, don't grudge one another. Don't cuss and quarrel and fight. You know what he's trying to tell us? Some of us, when we get impatient, you know, it brings out and breeds other things in us. Some of us get angry. Some of us get very, very jealous, or we get envious. For instance, if we're not getting the provisions we need, you're having hard times, but you hear of a brother or sister getting on well. In fact, they still have their job. Why them and not me? Don't grudge. That's what he's saying. Don't grudge, but wait on God. Why are they always blessed? Even in difficult times, they are still okay. What's wrong with me? What's wrong with you? Trust God. That's what God wants you to do. Trust him. And so, be careful, because you can be judged for that. Verse 10 says, take my brethren, the prophets, take them as examples who have spoken in the name of the Lord for an example of suffering afflictions. He says, you the prophets, man, they went through a lot. They know what it means to endure until the end. They went through their affliction. So he says, use them as examples. And Job would have been one to be mentioned. But verse 11 brings out the same idea of endurance. Verse 11 says, behold, we count them happy which endure. He says, take the prophets as example. And he says, we count them happy. We regard them as blessed who have endured. We look at their lives and say, like Job, he endured. Elijah, they endured, and so forth. Elisha, all of the different prophets, they endured, and we regard that. He wants us to understand, as you regard them as people who endured, what about you? Use them as example and understand they endured to the end, and so can you. Because this is how it is going to end. You have heard of the patience of Job and have seen the end of the Lord, that the Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy. He says, use these examples. You have regarded them as patient people and have endured much. He says, use that as an example. And he says, look at them as an example of how they resulted. What was the end result of them? How did God provide for Job? After he lost so much, God then restored him twice as much. He says, look at the end result of faithful people. Look at the end result of patient people. My friend, if you endure to the end, your result will also be good with God. Your end result will come out well. But you have to be patient. You cannot give up. You must endure to the end. We know how it will end for believers. By the way, we know how it will end for believers. The end of the story is that we shall overcome, which is the second point I want to get into. We shall overcome. So we must endure to the end because we shall overcome. We know the end of the story. We know how it is going to end. We will overcome. We shall overcome. We must overcome. We win. We have the victory. Our story ends well, my friends. We already know what's going to happen with us. We end well. So while you are going through all kinds of difficulties and you're not too sure how it's going to work out, in fact, you're saying, I don't know what's going to happen next. Can I ask you to fast forward to a longer future? Fast forward to eternity. I know how it's going to end. It's going to end well for us because we're overcomers, my friends. If you're going through a difficulty, I want to encourage you with the brightest smile and the most anticipated face and expression of all to say, we shall overcome. We end well. So I want to share with you some verses that strengthen that we shall overcome. In fact, let's start with 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5, verse 4. To 5, and it says, for whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? My friends, in case you missed that, here's what it is saying. Anybody who believes in Jesus Christ for salvation is an overcomer. Whoever believes in Jesus, you have already won the victory. Whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ, you trusted him for salvation, you have overcome. In fact, we could pack up our bags, I could stop the sermon, and you should be good to go by that, by just knowing that. You should be good to go because just being an overcomer by faith, just being an overcomer through your salvation means that you are heaven bound. It means that you're going to spend the rest of eternity with Jesus Christ. It means that you will never go to hell. It means that you are saved forever. That alone should actually give us more victory thoughts, victorious thoughts. That alone should give us more enthusiasm as you go through your struggle in COVID-19. It should give us more to think that, whoa, look at what is going to happen. But you know what I love about my God? He does give us more. Because we're going to look at not just that you're an overcomer by faith because you're saved. We're going to look now at the blessings that an overcomer has. You see, our God always gives us bonuses. Our God always gives us more. You know, can I, I'm going to do something a little different. You know, there's a verse that says that God does not give us more than we can bear. But can I flip that a little? Don't get me wrong, I'm not changing a scripture. I'm now just making a statement. He does not give us more than we can bear. But you see, when it comes down to blessing, he's going to give us more than we can contain. He's going to give us more than we deserve. So I want us to understand that he's going to give us more than we deserve. That is what is going to be fleshed out in Revelation. So let's look at some portions in Revelation. We're going to look now at some churches. All seven churches, actually. All seven churches that are mentioned in Revelation. And with each one, he says, to him that overcometh, I will do this. I want you to note that these churches, as you might know, some of these churches were never perfect. In fact, no church is perfect. Some were worse than others. Their spiritual conditions were bad. But I want you to know that within every church, he did promise something to the overcomers. So some of them might be living, you know, immoral lives and all of that. But then he keeps encouraging them at the end to say, those of you who are overcomers, those of you who have overcome, you're going to get these blessings. And I want you to look at these blessings as we go through. Let's look at the church at Ephesus. And I'm just going to read one verse for each church. Revelation chapter 2, verse 7. He says to the church at Ephesus, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. He says, those of us who overcome, the church, remember, you believe, so you're an overcomer already. You have already qualified. I don't want you to miss this, because sometimes we think of this idea of overcoming as to the works we do. This is not about your works. By you being a believer, you're an overcomer. And so because you're an overcomer, these blessings are promised to you. And he says, because of God's grace and his mercy towards us, you will partake in this tree of life. The tree that bears, at least it says, 12 different kinds of fruits. The tree that is abundant in its provisions in heaven. And then it says, Revelation 2 verse 11, at the church at Smyrna, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. What in the world is he talking about, and how does that even sound like a blessing? You will see in a moment that is a blessing to not experience the second death. What is the second death? According to Revelation chapter 20, it explains that after the great white throne judgment, all unbelievers, all of the wicked persons will be cast into the lake of fire. And it says this is the second death. The second death is the lake of fire. You must understand what's the first death. These are all people that would have died, and then their bodies were resurrected at the great white throne. So they are dead and now resurrected to be judged. And then they are going to be thrown into the lake of fire after that judgment. And then they will be there forever, which is why it's called a second death, because you're dead already and then you're going dead again forever and ever. So if you are a believer, you escape that. And that is something to praise God about. We're not going to the lake of fire. We will not be burning up forever and ever and ever. Now listen, if you're listening to this and you're not a believer, you should be scared right now. You should be very scared. But let me just put it this way. You don't have to stay scared. You can give your life to Jesus if you're unsaved, so that you don't have to be a part of the second death. And then you can share the same blessings that an overcomer will participate in. You can give your life to Jesus Christ so that you will escape the second death. Those of us who have already given our lives to Jesus Christ know that we escape the second death. Let me move on to the church at Pergamos. What is his blessing to them? In Revelation 2 verse 17, he says, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in that stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it. So In Revelation 2 verse 17 to the church at Pergamos, he promises two things. He says, a hidden manna and a white stone with a name on it. Let's talk about both of them. Now, there has been much debate over these ideas, especially the hidden manna, even the white stone, both of them. So the hidden manna, what does manna represent in the first place? Physical manna. Let's not talk about the hidden one. Let's talk about the exposed one, the known one first. Manna was bread that God sent to the Israelites in the time of need in the wilderness. You remember that? So there's the physical manna, bread from God. Now he says that those who overcome, he's going to give them hidden manna. So the idea of it being hidden can carry the idea of something being mysterious or symbolic, or simply put, something that is spiritual. While the Israelites got physical food, maybe God is promising us here a kind of hidden manna, meaning a spiritual food. He's going to be our sustenance. And so that is what it really means, a kind of spiritual food. And he doesn't tell us what it is. He uses the word hidden. So it's going to be a special surprise. Then he says, I'll give him a white stone. Before I look at this, the name in the stone, it says a white stone. Well, you know, some people might be saying, boy, a white stone doesn't sound so impressive. Let me bring to you some things that used to happen in the days of the culture. A white stone could be used for different things, and they were smooth, nice looking stones. Stones, white stones could be used in the culture to actually use as tickets, a ticket to enter into a banquet. So you use the stone, your stone was like your ticket. The stone was also used as a mark of freedom for slaves. So when they are freed by their masters, they'll get a stone. And if they are going through any pilgrimage or any place, they just use the stone and say, this is my ticket to freedom. And so there's also that idea that even athletes were given a nice, smooth, white stone as a token, as a symbol, as a reward. And so the white stone represented some kind of token or reward. And it says, and in the stone, a new name written. So understand that he didn't tell you what the name is. No man knoweth saving or except he that receiveth it. So we don't need to debate over what the names are. He's not going to tell us. But we're going to get these white stones and special names written on them. The stones represent a token of favor and prosperity and approval from God. And so God is going to give us tokens of approval. He's going to bless us with that. Let's move on. The church at Thyatira, Revelation 2 verse 26. And he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations. Wow. That's big, you know. That's huge. If you are a child of God, one day we're going to rule and reign with God. We're going to get power and authority over the nations. Let me just put it this way. None of us deserve that. I don't care who you are, whether you are Moses, whether you are Elijah, whether you are Abraham, Paul, John, nobody deserves that. No matter how good we were and how much we have done for God, we don't deserve that. But God is going to give us opportunity to rule power over the nations. That's huge. That's why I say to you that we shall overcome right now in the coronavirus times. Some of us are on lockdown and we can't even rule our street. We cannot walk outside. Some of us cannot go into another neighborhood. We cannot fly to another place. I could not fly to St. Martin to speak to you today because of coronavirus. But there's going to be a day, oh praise God, when we can fly anywhere. We will rule the nations, praise God. What a day that will be. And then it goes on to say here, the church at Sardis, Revelation 3, verse 5. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. You're going to get this wonderful white garment, white robe that represents the purity and the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And it says, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life. I leave that as self-explanatory, meaning that you will not be going to hell or lake of fire, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. I want you to notice that last phrase. Jesus is the one that's speaking, and he's saying, those of you who overcome, Those of you who are Christians, I'm going to confess your name before my Father and before his angels. That word confess also means acknowledge, you know. It doesn't always mean like you're confessing any sins. This is going to be a grand and good time, not a bad time. So he's saying, I'm going to acknowledge you before the Father, acknowledge you before the angels. I'm going to declare, here is Pastor Madden. Here is Pastor Webster. Here is Pastor White. This is Jesus, you know. It's, think of it like a great throne room. What a prestige God is going to give us. What a prestigious moment it will be. A privileged moment where he's going to declare, here is so and so. It's like you're in a throne room and God is declaring and acknowledging you. It's like what we say in Jamaica. He's going to big you up. Wow. We don't even deserve that, but he's going to big you up. And he's going to do so before the Father and before the angels. We're going to get more than we deserve than the church at Philadelphia. Revelation 3 verse 12. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of God, and he shall go no more out. And I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God. And I will write upon him my new name. And that was mentioned earlier in another passage too. The new name. He's going to give us a new name. There's a new name written down in glory. We don't know what it is, but it's going to be special. We're going to get a new identity. But he speaks to the idea of a pillar in the temple. He's going to make a pillar in the temple of God. All right? Now, understand that this may be symbolic or figurative. Even the idea of what used to happen in the culture, where when you had the temple, there were special pillars where they'd write, engrave the names of people who had accomplished much, great achievements, and their names were engraved, much like how many of our countries and our islands do. We have pillars where we engrave names to certain people who have done much, heroes and heroines. It's the same idea that he's going to give us this privilege of making us known. What a thing. Making us known in heaven when the only person that we should be making known is him. What a privilege. And then he says to the church at Laodicea, the final one, the seventh one, Revelation 3 verse 21, to him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. Now, I'm toning down because I am just humbled at this point. I want you to think of all the stuff Jesus is promising to us before this, you know. And as I heard them, I don't know about you, I was overwhelmed. Ruling nations, tree of life, name with new names, special pillars, you name it. And then here he comes and tells us that will grant to sit with him in my throne. Can I put it this way? I'm overwhelmed. I'm humbled. We don't deserve to share any throne with God anywhere. But look at what he's going to give us. So can I say something to you? If you're there and you're moping, and you're a believer, and you're depressed, and you're saying, boy, how long will I have to stay in this house, locked up and shut down? I want you to understand there's coming a day when you're going to be exalted and exposed, and meaning in a good way, and even to share throne with Jesus. May I say to you, endure what you're going through and then wait, because the latter is going to be greater. Verse 21, verse 7 says, he that overcometh shall inherit all things. And this is where I'll conclude. He that overcometh shall inherit all things. And I will be his God, and he shall be my son. That is like a wrap-up, you know. That's a conclusive statement. He expressed many things. Jesus expressed many things before. He pointed out some things. He was specific. And now, I think that this last phrase is simply saying, anything else I didn't mention, you're going to get everything else. He that overcometh shall inherit all things. My gosh, God is going to give us. Now you understand when I say that he's going to give us more than we can contain. The only thing is that we'll have new bodies so we can bear it. But he's going to give us more than we deserve. So yes, no is hard. Yes, times are rough, but you need to realize what's going to happen later. Endure what you are going through right now. Endure your trials and your afflictions and your hardships. Endure your heartaches and your pains. Get past, power through your depression. Power through your emotional setbacks and financial setbacks. Power through them. Endure it to the end, my friends. Because we shall overcome someday. We have already overcome by just being a believer in Christ. And then in the future, eternity future, we're going to overcome. We're going to live with God. We're going to enjoy all the blessings. So here's what I want to close by saying to you. Endure to the end so that you can enjoy the blessings forever. Endure so that you can enjoy. My friends, don't give up. This is how you go forward in faith. Through Corona and after Corona, endure in order to enjoy. May I pray for you as God would just have me pray a blessing upon you. Lord, we come before you and we ask, dear God, that you will just bless Good News Baptist Church. We thank you for your blessings upon them over these years and how they have served you faithfully. We ask, dear God, that you will just give them more blessings. Help them to be that beacon and that light in the island of St. Martin. Help them to enjoy this moment, this milestone. But right now it's difficult with all of these things happening. So help them to endure and not give up. Help them to look back at how you have brought them through and then to look forward to how you will bring them through. So we ask that you will bless them, bless the church and the members, bless Pastor Webster, Pastor White, and their families, God. Bless everyone, dear God. And Lord, I pray that you will indeed just use these times to help them to get closer to you personally. Bless them and help them to find ways to continue to keep connected with each other, ways to keep the gospel spreading, ways to encourage one another. And in these times, we need to do that. So God, bless them. We pronounce a blessing upon their church. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you.
Hi, Good News. I want to let you know how honored I am to be a part of Good News Baptist Church family. On behalf of our pastor, Pastor Webster, Mrs. Webster, and Pastor White, I would like to say thank you and congratulations on your 52nd church anniversary. Also, a great big note of thanks to everyone who had a part in this celebration. A great big thank you to all the pastors, all the great men of God who ministered and encouraged us in the word. We are delighted to have so many of you this year to share God's word on this special Mother's Day. Thank you, pastors, and thank you, Pastor Webster, for this great idea. God is awesome. To our online viewers, thank you for streaming with us. We do hope that you were blessed. Once again, I say thank you, Good News. Thank you to your big day. And thank you, all mothers all over the world. Have a great Mother's Day. We love you. We know it's not a usual one for us, but we know that God is in control. May you be blessed and stay safe. We love you.
Welcome to the Good News Baptist Church website. It has been completely redesigned, especially for these trying times while we are not able to physically attend church service. Our aim is to make information more accessible and provide a significantly improved user experience. Our website will feature frequent updates, and new messages in addition to our social media and video activities. The website is also optimized for tablets and smartphones, providing more ways for you to follow us. We wanted to enhance your experience of our church services from a distance and hope you enjoy our new website and its features. The design gives a light, fresh, and new feeling. The navigation has been restructured so that it is now easier to directly access specific content on our site. It also provides an easy access to the most frequently retrieved content, like our live streams. All links to the topics in the main navigation, for example, who we are, leads to clearly laid out subpages. The subpages features two main sections that can be reached by clicking on the corresponding tab. The overview section provides entry-level information that's easy to access and helps to get familiar with the topic. More in-depth information can be found once you click on the Read More button. The new design has a feature for those living abroad to donate with our Easy Access Donate Now button. Members can also use it to pay tithes by just clicking on the Donate Now button, then following the simple steps required. Users can also subscribe for our good news updates here. There is so much more to discover. Visit the all-new Good News Baptist Church website at gnbcnetwork.org. Designed for a better experience.